handshaking and hugging, turn your Bible to the book of 2 Kings chapter 6. Can I say tonight I love, it blesses my soul to hear kids behind me?
Yeah.
Like you don't hear one all day long.
Well, I know, but I don't usually hear them here.
What did he say?
2 Kings 6.
And if they get loose and run while I'm preaching, just let them run.
What our pastor says.
I've got a 19-month-old daughter, and my wife and I will try to keep her wrangled and stuff. My favorite thing in the world is when I get preaching at the... get preaching, and she'll get beside me at the altar and have a song book there with it open and just pointing and hollering. I mean, that blesses my soul. So let them run. Amen. I love it.
I agree.
2 Kings chapter 6 this evening. Beginning of verse number 8. Just have a little thought to share with you. It says, then the king of Syria warred against Israel and took counsel with his servants, saying, in such a place shall be my camp. And the man of God sent unto the king of Israel, saying, beware that thou pass not such a place, for thither the Syrians are come down. And the king of Israel sent to the place which the man of God told him and warned him of, and saved himself there not once nor twice. Therefore the heart of the king of Syria was sore troubled for this thing, and he called his servants and said unto them, will ye not show me which one of us is for the king of Israel? And one of his servants said, none, my lord, O king, but Elisha, the prophet that is in Israel, telleth the king of Israel the words that thou speakest in thy bedchamber. And he said, go and spy where he is, that I may send and fetch him. And it was told him, saying, behold, he's in Dothan. Therefore sent he thither horses and chariots and a great host, and they came by night and compassed the city about. And when the servant of the man of God was risen early and gone forth, behold, an host compassed the city, both with horses and chariots. And his servant said unto him, alas, my master, how shall we do? And he answered, fear not, for they that be with us or more than they that be with them. And Elisha prayed and said, Lord, I pray thee, open his eyes that he may see. And the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire round about Elisha. And when they came down to him, Elisha prayed unto the Lord and said, smite this people, I pray thee, with blindness. And he smote them with blindness according to the word of Elisha. And Elisha said unto them, this is not the way, neither is this the city. Follow me, and I will bring you to the man whom ye see. But he led them to Samaria. And it came to pass, when they were come into Samaria, that Elisha said, Lord, open the eyes of these men, that they may see. And the Lord opened their eyes, and they saw, and behold, they were in the midst of Samaria. And the king of Israel said unto Elisha, when he saw them, my father, shall I smite them? Shall I smite them? And he answered, thou shalt not smite them. Wouldest thou smite those whom thou hast taken captive with thy sword and with thy bowl? Set bread and water before them that they may eat and drink and go to their master. And he prepared great provision for them, and when they had eaten and drunk, he sent them away, and they went to their master. So the bands of Syria came no more into the land of Israel. You may be seated. Let us pray. Lord, Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for the blessings of being in your house this evening. Lord, we thank you for the good songs that we've heard, Lord, that brought glory unto your name this evening. We thank you that they've been about Jesus Christ. And Lord, we thank you, Lord, for the good testimonies that we've heard tonight, Lord, and how they've honored your name, Lord, and talked about what you've done, Lord. Lord, I never get tired of hearing somebody tell me what Jesus did. Lord, I never get tired of somebody telling me how good God's been to them. Lord, we thank you this evening, Lord, that you're still going out of your way to give a kind word to somebody. Lord, that you're still going out of your way, amen, to hear a prayer. Lord, that you're still going out of your way, Lord, amen, to bless your people. We thank you this evening. Lord, that you can be in a doctor's office. Lord, that you can be beside the interstate. Lord, that you can be in the house of prayer. Lord, that you'll be wherever your people are gathered together in your name, you'll be in the midst. And we thank you this evening Lord, we thank you for the display of love, Lord, and family. We thank you for that this evening and the blessing that is. And Lord, we ask you now as we come to this part of the service, we ask you as always to give us the words that are needed for the hour. Lord, we don't have any way of knowing what one person stands in need of in entirety. Lord, for we don't know tomorrow. But Lord, if we knew everything about one person, everything that we needed to know about one person's needs, we couldn't choose one message for that one person. But Lord, only you can take one message from your book and apply it to all of our hearts. So Lord, we ask you to do that this evening. Lord, for only you know what each of us have been through today, and even more so, only you know what each of us will face tomorrow. Lord, we ask you to open all of our hearts, Lord, to hear what thus saith the Lord this evening. Lord, it would never be about us and them, but Lord, it'd be about all of us and the power of thy holy word. And we'll trust your promise that your word will not return void, but it will accomplish that which you set it out to do. We love you, Lord, and we thank you. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Of the mental image that I get whenever I read this passage of Scripture. Y'all know I have a wild imagination a little bit. The way I sometimes say it, if you don't like the way I picture it, don't worry about it. You picture it yourself. But the way I just, when I read this passage of Scripture, I feel like I'm reading a movie. I just picture it. The servant of the man of God, the servant of Elisha, he gets up. Elisha is sitting there at the house or whatever, or the tent or whatever they got at the time. It don't say, so I just picture it as a house. It don't have to be. They're in the city, so that's why I assume that. But anyway, they're in the little house, and Elisha's sitting there at their table or whatever he's got. And I just picture him sitting there sipping on a cup of coffee. You say they might not have been doing that. That's fine. You picture joy, okay? I'm giving you my picture. I just picture Elisha sitting there sipping on his morning coffee. And his servant gets up. He's kind of still drowsy, just got out of bed. He said he got up early. He said he's a young man and he got up early. So I know he was still sleeping. Amen. It goes right there. So he got up early and he kind of stumbles his way out through there to go visit the outhouse. He goes outside to the outhouse and comes back out, and then he notices something. Now he's awake enough and he sees everything that's surrounding him. Sees that literally an army has encamped round about their little town. That literally an army of the enemy has come specifically for them. And I can just see the panic. Where he came out, kind of moseying along, now he's running back to the house. Elisha, what are we going to do? Have you seen what's outside? And I just picture Elisha. Takes another sip of coffee. Yep. Eyes like dinner plates. The servant, Elisha, the Syrians have us surrounded. What are we going to do? Elisha just looks at him. Another sip of coffee. Daily the Lord loaded us with benefits. I remember that every morning when I make my coffee. And he takes another sip of coffee and says, nothing. What? I see the panic and doesn't even know what to say. He doesn't have words. He's kind of running around acting like a chicken with his head cut off. And Elisha begins to pray the simple prayer of verse number 17, where we'll take our text from this evening. And Elisha prayed and said, Lord, I pray thee, open his eyes that he may see. And Elisha he prayed, looks like 3 seconds. Prayed about 3 seconds, and Elisha looks up and says, why don't you go take another look? Why don't you just peek outside one more time? Why don't you just look and see if things are like you think they was. And the Lord, to finish the verse, buses and chariots of fire round about Elisha. I realized something today as I was reading this passage that I've always kind of just assumed part of it that the Bible doesn't actually say. And we don't really know one way or the other, so you can take it either way, but it never says that Elisha saw them. It says that the servants saw the chariots of fire encamped round about it. It never says that Elisha saw that himself. I always just pictured it assuming that he did. And maybe he did, or maybe he didn't. But either way, we can know for Elisha to make the statement that he made in verse number 16, "Fear not, for they that be with us are more than they that be with them." For him to make that statement, we know this, that he had to be looking through eyes of faith. So that's what we want to preach on for just a moment this evening. We'll not be long, but I just want to preach for just a moment on eyes of faith. Now, we've all quoted 2 Corinthians 5 and 7 probably many times in our lives. 2 Corinthians 5 and 7, very familiar scripture. You'll find it on bookmarks. You'll find it on plaques. You'll find it just quoted casually in conversation. Any time that somebody's come up against a battle, we'll say, "For we walk by faith, not by sight." And that's good. But I would dare say that most of the time that we quote that, if not all the time that we quote that, we don't realize or we don't remember. I'm not saying you've never read it, I'm not saying you've never seen it, but we don't remember in the moment that what that is actually in the verse is a parenthetical expression, literally in parentheses, in the middle of another sentence. And so then when we go back and we get the rest of the sentence, it says this: "Therefore, we are always confident, knowing that whilst we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight." Still in the same sentence. We haven't got a period yet. We've got colons. "We are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord." And now we finally end the sentence. So verse number 6, when we look at that, he says this: "Therefore we are always confident, knowing that whilst we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord." We are absent from the Lord. Paul, the apostle to the Gentiles, as he would often call himself, the apostle Paul, saying, "We are absent from the Lord." Now that seems kind of contradictory when we think about what Christ told us. He said, "I'll go with you all the way, even unto the end of the world." But we realize what Paul is saying is that we are not physically with him. We realize, we know, amen, that we who are saved, that God is with you in spirit, that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. You're bought with your price, and you're not bought with a price, and you're not your own. And Paul would even say in Acts chapter 17 and verse number 27, during his sermon at Mars Hill in Athens, he would say this: that he be not far from every one of us, speaking lost or saved, be not far from every one of us. But the fact is that we're still waiting to be physically present with him. I can't, just speaking physically now, I can't reach my hand out and shake hands with Jesus. In my spirit, I can't tell you how many times I've done it. But physically, we're still waiting, amen, for that earthly tabernacle to go back to 5:1. For we know that if our earthly house and this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. See, there's still a part that we're waiting on. We're not physically with him. And that's why he says verse number 7. Because we're not physically with Christ yet, we still have to walk by faith, amen, not by sight. If I could try to put what I'm trying to say into plain language this evening, I'd say it like this: I see God everywhere.
Amen.
The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. I can't look around and not see God.
Amen.
I see God when I look at every time I see a stink bug now, instead of squashing it, I just want to look at it because Clarence pointed out how much it looks like a shield. It ain't by accident that every bug's got designs on it. Yeah. Only God. There is no purpose, if I can say it that way, for a stink bug to be so pretty, except God blessing his people. There is no purpose for a ladybug to be such a nice bright hemi-orange with black racing dots. Amen, that thing got a hemi. There's no purpose for that except God. There's no... I see God when I look at the intricate design in a bug, or I look at a turtle and just see how it's got the concentric rings on every one of the panels of its shell, and the panels overlap onto each other like a roof. And I see the hand of God. I see when I look at the sky at night as the sun begins to sink below the horizon, and instead of being the bright blue that it's been all day long, you just begin to see shades of orange and yellow and red. And I see God when it rises again with the same colors appear and then slowly turns into blue again. I see God in a smile, in a handshake, in a hug, in a testimony, amen, in a song that uplifts my soul, in a testimony that tells me something I need to hear, in a message that helps me to grow or tells me to repent. I see the Lord. It's impossible for me to look around and not see God. And yet, many people, actually, based on the testimony of the Word of God, the majority of people, I don't ever try to put a number on it, but I know what the words many and the words few mean. By the testimony of the Word of God, the majority of people look at the exact same evidence, look at the same bugs, don't see God.
Amen.
Look at the same sky and are more likely to see an alien than to see God. Look at the same glory of creation and don't see the glory of the Creator. It's all a coincidence. Had to happen based on mathematical probability over infinite time, every scenario has to occur. Really? That's what you're going with? See, the difference is God doesn't require blind faith. God gives us plenty of ways to see Him. The number one way being in His book.
Man.
There is no book like God's book. There is no book that tells us things, writes things thousands of years before they would happen, and then they happen as if the person who wrote it was watching it happen. There is no other book where he'll write a scientific fact 3,000 years before science would discover it. Jonah would write that he went down into the ocean and saw the mountains. Science would discover he was right in the 1950s. Once we had radar after World War II, we discovered that Jonah was right. Big shock, God knew what he was writing in his book. There is no book like God's book. Amen. And yet, God does not require blind faith, but to see God requires eyes of faith. It does not require me to have faith that's based on nothing. He gives me plenty to base my faith on. Amen. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. He gives me plenty of opportunity to build faith. And yet, to see God, it requires eyes of faith. But Going back to our text, it's easy for me to look with eyes of faith at the sunrise, as I mentioned, and say, man, ain't God awesome? It's easy for me to look with eyes of faith when I'm sitting there with my cup of coffee and everything's just peachy. But we're the ones that woke up like the servant. It's harder to look with eyes of faith. It's a lot easier, when we wake up the day before, let me say it this way, the day before when the servant got up, I bet he had all kinds of faith. The day before, when there was no army encamped around about him, I bet that servant's strength was as strong as could be. And let me tell you this, when you have a need, my strength, faith is as strong as it gets. When you have a need, I absolutely believe beyond a shadow of a doubt. When I'm not putting on airs. When you ask for prayer and I tell you, I believe God will help you. Amen. I believe it. Amen. But when we have the need,
yes,
it's harder. When we're the one, amen, that woke up and we see the enemy encamped round about, if I can use the image from this passage, when we're the one that woke up and you get that call with a bad report, when you're the one that wakes up, amen, and things are not hunky-dory, when there's problems in your family, when there's problems in your community, when you're the one, amen, that's standing in the feet, in the shoes of the servant, it becomes harder.
Amen.
To look at things through eyes of faith. But that's the day we need it more than any. That's the day that we need those eyes of faith more than any other. Lord gave me a new clarencism this evening. Sometimes we walk by sight with faith rather than walking by faith. What do I mean? I'm not saying you're not saved by no stretch of the imagination. I ain't saying that you don't have faith. But I'm saying that our sight is what's driving our reactions. What we see is what's affecting how we react rather than what we believe. What we see around us is what affects our emotion. What we see around us is what affects our action rather than what we believe to be true based upon the truth of the Word of God. What am I talking about? Well, Elisha's servant certainly had faith. He was a servant of the greatest, or maybe only, no, it shouldn't be only. There were still, Lord told Elijah he still had 7,000, so I don't reckon all them had died by the time Elisha was around. But the greatest, I know it wasn't true, because Elisha, if you go back earlier in the chapter, he's talking about the school of the prophets. So anyway, I know it's not the only, but the greatest prophet in Israel at that time, this servant works for him. Now, if you're going to have faith, if you're going to be in a position to grow faith, well, you ain't a good spot to be in. So I believe tonight that this fellow had faith. But when he saw the army encamped round about him, what drove his reaction was not his faith. It was his sight. He was walking by sight with faith. How do I know he still had faith? Because he didn't run off. He went into the man of God. He didn't lay his faith down. He didn't forget that God was in control. He didn't forget that God was able to do something. He went right to the person that he knew could answer. He still had faith. But he lost his peace because his reaction came from his sight. Elisha was the exact opposite. I don't see Elisha get alarmed at all in this situation. I ain't got there yet. I'll be right honest with you. I ain't got to that level of faith. I kind of like talk to Elisha and say, "What? How do you get to this level of faith? That when you insurmountable problem. The faith is so much greater than your eyes. That his reaction was not driven by his sight. Whether he saw the army of God or not, he still saw the army of Syria. Whether he saw that God was camped round about him or not, he knew that God was in control.
Amen.
I don't know about y'all tonight. I need some help to walk with eyes of faith.
Amen.
I'll be the first one to tell you, there's some days that I got, if I can just say it this way and y'all understand what I mean, that it feels like I got plenty of faith for any obstacle that comes up. And then there's some other days when the obstacle comes up. And I realize, boy, Lord, I could use some more of it. Boy, Lord, I know you said that you give unto every man a measure of faith. I take another measure, Lord, if it be all right with you. So tonight, I just want to invite you to examine our vision. So, Lord, am I looking around me with my natural eyes? Or am I reacting based on what I know you've said? Am I reacting what I believe from your word? Or am I reacting to what I see? Am I walking with eyes of flesh or walking with eyes of faith? Let us pray. Lord, Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for letting me preach it myself again. I appreciate it, Lord. You'd be willing to help us. We thank you. Lord, I know tonight that we're all made out of the same old stuff. Lord, so if I need to grow my faith, and Lord, I read of others in your word that needed to grow their faith, I believe that all of us could stand to grow our faith this evening. So Lord, I ask you to help each one, Lord, to examine where we stand. Lord, to grow in that way you'd have us to grow. Lord, to trust. Lord, when we cannot see. Lord, when we can't see how you're moving, just to trust that you're moving. When we cannot see what you're doing, just to trust that you are doing. And Lord, I know we'll grow in that. We love you, Lord, and we thank you. Apply the message to every heart. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen.